Hello, everybody, and welcome to Blades in the Dark, which was originally just a one-shot, and now we're just, like, doing this sometimes. It's a once-in-a-while shot. You'll have noticed that John made us a super cool background for this one, so we got all this production value stuff going on. So welcome. Thanks for coming. And let me introduce my fellow nerds in case you haven't gotten a chance to watch the other one. So you'll recognize our GM, John Harper, from the Apocalypse World game that we were running over on Roll20, and you'll see more of John very soon for the recently announced Dungeons & Dragons game that we're going to be playing. I know. So excited. Hi, John. Thanks Hello. For GMing for us. I never get to play games. This is so nice.
I know. I feel like... This is gonna be black as, I was gonna say black as white, but I almost said black is down, up is white.
I mean, yeah, that too.
Everything's upside down today.
Yep. So also we have Sean Nittner as RC Keel today. Hi, Sean.
Hey.
Sean is like one of the busiest people I know aside from myself. Like, you got shit going on. So it's kind of a miracle we could get everybody together for this.
Yeah, I know. I'm stoked about it though.
I know. And filling out the retinue of crime and villainy, our weird magic teenager, Strash. Hi, Strash. It's good to see you.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going good. I'm excited. John, do you want to tell us a little about your game?
Sure.
Can you intro for us? Because I know that some people have been tuning in for the show so far. They've been with the gang since the beginning. But let's give everybody else a rundown.
Yeah. So. Blades in the Dark is my game about fantasy crime, basically. You play a group of scoundrels in a weird, semi-industrial, steampunky city that's haunted by ghosts, and you choose what type of crime you like to do. Like, you might do smuggling or thievery or whatever it is. You make a crew around that concept, and then you pull heists and scores and make your way through the criminal underworld. So it's kind of sandboxy. You know, there's a lot of different factions of criminals and cops, and it's got a little bit of the Wire aspect to it, where you're kind of moving up through the ranks and trying to stay ahead of the law and your rivals and stuff. So you guys are all playing scoundrels in a crew of hawkers, which are like the kind of drug dealers in this case, people who sell illegal stuff. And I play the world and all the enemies and factions, and we see what happens to your crew. Do you make it? Do you not make it? That's what we play to find out.
I'm going to select for favorite crime all of the above.
We'll do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. You want this, like, the general jack of all trades crime
game. All criming. I won't turn down crimes.
It's funny that you say that too, because it is the crew type, like, helps focus the group. But it's definitely not exclusive. As the game goes on, it's like, you know what we should do? Murder.
Yeah, I believe we call that PC opportunism, John.
Yeah. Like,
you see a rich old guy. Oh, really? Well, let's totally roll that guy. But I thought you were trying to do this, like, antique deal. Nope, rolling the old man. Because he's there.
He's a type of antique.
I think our last session, actually, was that you have a problem. We're going to sell it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
every
totally.
Problem is profit in disguise.
Exactly. That's right.
Yeah, so you guys, we don't need to recap the whole last session, I guess, but, like, in brief, you're trying to start out, you like took someone's turf, took their corner, basically, this tattoo parlor to sell your drugs in from, and you didn't have any drugs, so you decided to sell raw demon blood to whoever would buy it and
that's
shoot it into their
kind
veins.
Of drug.
Like you do.
I think the analogy someone made last time was that it's like magical crocodile, which
well, if you think about it from like the exotic perspective of whether it has any effect or not, but just like people will pay for like donkey penis, you know, like of course people would pay for Leviathan blood because it's crazy.
Yeah. It's true. We're selling the shark fin soup equivalent of this world.
Shark fin, exactly. Only we shoot it up and it kills people or turns them into something.
I've been eating shark fin soup all wrong then, if that's not what you're supposed to do. Shit. No wonder it wasn't working.
So yeah, the last time we played, we discovered that shooting demon blood or drinking it or whatever people did is really bad for you, strangely enough. And
you don't say.
It started turning people into weird things, demons maybe, it's hard to tell. Fortunately, you discovered that the group of thugs you had paid to watch the store were throwing the corrupted bodies in the basement in a big pile.
Yeah, that would be Cyclops and the fine thugs.
Yes, yeah, Cyclops, our favorite nice. NPC so far. Adam's character, Cantor, being an enterprising lad, the only like legit street criminal in the crew, he came up with the wonderful idea of selling off the corrupted demonic bodies to a buyer.
Yeah, that's right. selling the weaponized toxic waste product of our drug production.
And thanks to Strasha's character, Oscar, thanks to his cousin, the creepy, weird vampire crime lord, Lord Skurlock. You were able to find a buyer and set up... you sold the current stock, so to speak, and set up future dealings of... I think it was established at the end of the last session that he expects more of these corrupted bodies to be slid through his mail slot in the future.
Well, and we don't expect there to not be a surplus of them based on what we're doing, so...
Right, what, you're not going to stop giving people raw demon blood, right?
That's well,
no, that would be ridiculous. Why would we do that?
Well, we might, actually, because Oscar did...
Says you.
Minus Quellen, who can now actually refine it to make a better product, so... We'll see.
You know what refinement costs? It costs money. So we just have two products. We are diversifying our portfolio.
Yep.
Welcome to the next 2 hours, Sean. I hope you're excited. I'm gonna make you do bad things that are not a good idea.
And bad things, this game is about bad things.
Exactly.
My character having any kind of morals is just an interesting road bump, speed bump to those bad things.
I'm really looking forward to finding the thing that is more of a priority than making more money for Cantor. It may not exist. It might just not be a thing.
Yeah, well.
We'll wait and find out.
Yeah. Late to find out, right?
Right. Yeah, so... As you said, Strash had his character Oscar had a connection, a witch that you brought on board as an expert. She has many strange skills, but one of them is sort of alchemy, and so she has been working on refining the raw demon blood and turning it into a more pure kind of. I was assuming it was a type of narcotic, but we haven't really discussed what the effects of it are yet.
I think we're also looking into... I have a project where I'm researching how to then convert it into weird and magical tattoo inks. So
yes.
That,
yes,
that was our... Initially, we would just jam a needle in people and then squeeze them in. But I think this is totally going to be slightly upgraded, fix our clientele, that kind of thing.
The old jam and squeeze.
Yeah.
Classic Gambit.
Yeah, which is really cool because the place was originally a tattoo parlor. You have all this tattooing materials and tools and stuff, and I think everybody was very much on board with this idea of demon blood.
Oh yeah,
ink tattoos.
I'd say, yeah, didn't Oscar? You had like a thing where you were like wanting to be weird about that.
Yeah.
Yes,
that's
is
everything.
That is pretty much everything.
I had to be more specific. It's true. It's true. Fair.
Yeah, so it's a project and. You know, where we sort of left off last time at the end of the score, having made a deal, Adam's character, Cantor, kind of stared down the vampire and held his ground and, like, smoothed the deal over and did a good job of setting up that relationship.
What's the name of Cantor and the Fine Thugs? It's our first album, Staring Down the Vampire.
That's right. and we sort of left off, we cut it right there, so
Yep. There's
some... downtime in this game, for people who don't know out there, you kind of do scores and then you have downtime. And during downtime, you take care of some logistics, but you also can focus on your own personal, your characters, you know, private projects or whatever they're passionate about. And possibly most importantly, you can indulge your character's vice. Each of the characters has a vice that demands their attention and helps them relieve stress. So,
word.
That's the phase of the game we're heading into, having made the deal with Skurlock. There's maybe a week or so of downtime here as the crew transitions from a shitty, ripped up, abandoned building selling raw demon blood to somewhat presentable future tattoo parlor and drug den.
That was another thing that while Oscar was parlaying this deal with Skurlock, Cancer and Arcee were talking to Cyclops about sort of upping the security, and so we established that there's now some protocols, and people don't just like take the money and then hand you the blood. There's like the handoffs.
Yeah, there's pass offs and stuff. Yeah.
There's some scouts on the roof. There's like you pay here, but you shoot up over there. Sort of protocols, so that any blue coat can't just walk by and sort of see what's going on without even trying. They have to at least try a little now. To see what our enterprise is.
Yeah.
Because we had some heat from last time, right? Like there was a little bit of like
we're
starting to get some notice. Okay.
Yeah.
Got a little heat. Two out of eight, I believe. So you're
right. I got that covered.
You're doing okay on the heat meter right now.
Yeah.
But that's true. Cyclops is in charge of security. He knows what's supposed to go down and. He and the
it's
other
good. We put the one-eyed dude in charge of security.
Oh, lookout! Yeah,
that's right.
Panopticon over here.
One of your the most recent in a long line of good choices.
Story of my life.
Yeah. I guess we can kind of switch into downtime mode and. You can take a look at the downtime sheet there and see if any of those things jump out. I know you all kind of already have some ideas of what you're doing, but if you need to be jogged a bit, there's a list
I'm ready choices. To go.
Yeah, I can tell, Sean. Like you're just ready, and I am too. I'm totally ready for Arcee's stuff. So maybe that's a good place to start.
I'm gonna do a downtime action then. And I am. I'm going to indulge my advice with my husband second, because I think this is important to have first, and that is reducing heat. In the last session, we rolled entanglements, and Marlene got picked up, and she did so well at resisting. Not only did she not give us our names, she also got the names of the two blue coats
You were going to ice those motherfuckers.
Shake her down, yes.
That's right. You were going to go 187 on a fool.
Do you?
I have their names here. Yes.
Yeah. Who are they again?
Their names are Cinda and Rafe. And Marlene is a pugilist. She fights for money down by the docks. Usually, she's Arcee's lover. Correct. Also, part of the reason why Arcee and her husband are Splitsville. Not to mention the fact that you led a mutiny on the Leviathan ship that you were supposed to. Be an officer on, and you're a wanted criminal.
These things happen in a marriage. You know, you reach the like 7-year slump. You have a mutiny or two.
That's right.
You know, you gotta plan for these things.
At a time, right? So, so we know these officers' names, so we have this a little bit of downtime. And blue coats have vices like everyone else, and. Arcee and Marlene are going to spend some time finding out where they are, finding out where they live, and then once we know where they live, bring Cyclops and the thugs with hoods over our faces to drag them out of their beds in the middle of the night and hold knives to their throats over the edge of a canal that we could drop them into.
Uh-huh.
That's the plan, at least.
And cool. This is why you're part of our gang.
Yeah,
I'm glad it's you getting up on these cops and not me, because this could go so wrong. I'm excited. Right. No, I mean I'm supportive of you.
So
go
this
and
is
do
the
this.
Plan, at least. The plan is to.
So Sean, is this something? Is Arcee gonna slip away and do this, or do you tell Cantor and Oscar about your plan?
I think Arcee just. I mean, unless any of you guys would like. Feel like this would like be terrible for her to do on her own. Arcee's doing this because she's mad at Cantor. Or she's mad at herself, really. She's mad at herself for going along with Cantor, and she just wants to punch something. And this seems like the, like, she's letting out that anger of being like, we're working with a vampire, we're selling half demons, we're trafficking in, you know, we're doing all this crap.
And I mean, half 50% demon is, that's a big number. I mean, it's like 15-20% at most. Come on.
Right.
Let's be real here.
As a professional, I declare it to be around 10.
Yeah, see, look at this. That's what I'm saying.
Right.
That's barely demon at all.
So these are the kind of conversations that cause Arcee to leave in the middle of the night and say, fuck you guys.
It's true. It's true. I am impossible to get along with.
Fuck you guys. I'm going to go drinking. And yeah. Drinking turns into, well, you know, what we should really do is find these guys. So maybe it's less planned than all that, and maybe it's just grabbing them at some point.
Maybe you're out on the town, and you're with Marlene, of course, and the topic comes up that she got picked up, and it goes without saying that she stood tall and didn't give the Bluecoats any info. As you're talking about it, you know, I didn't really see Marlene on screen too much. I'm picturing her as who am I thinking? Hilary Swank, kind of, from The Fighter, like, kind of like this really, like, wiry, tough-looking, but, like, kind of small and fierce type. I don't know what you were thinking. Maybe you're going the other way there. Maybe she's big strong.
I could absolutely... we've kind of established that Arcee's pretty big, broad-shouldered, so I think it makes... makes sense for Marlene to be
there's some contrast there. She's
and
I think I was gonna say unlike Arcee, but this isn't true. Like, you married into a noble family,
correct?
We don't know your background specifically, but we know that you weren't of noble birth yourself.
Her background is labor, but you know.
Yeah, so I feel like you and Marlene have that in common, and you both kind of come from that world, and so you're in your element when you're with her, you know, instead of your previous life where you're kind of this outsider to the noble life and everything. So let's set a quick little scene here. Maybe you're at a fight. Maybe you got, like, watching a fight or something like that.
Sure, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, some of that bare-knuckle boxing shit.
There's a lot. Oh,
yeah.
Chip Cyclops, that's where I like to drink, is down by the docks, where fights are, you know, Marlene normally competes. I think she might have just gotten out of a bout, and now we're sort of watching the next one.
Nice.
Nursing, you know, something with a black eye, but that's sort of par for the course.
Yeah, it's like a warehouse, and the stevedores and the dock workers are off work. Duskwall, you know, it's always night in Duskwall, but there's levels of night. You know, there's sort of twilight, dusk, midnight kind of situation. It's sort of like a dusk situation. So there's some dim, faint amber light coming through the slats on the sides of the warehouse. They moved pallets of supplies and stuff that have come off the ships to make a makeshift squared circle kind of space there on the stone floor for the pugilists to wail on each other.
Nice.
I like that you got to use both stevedore and pugilist in that description. Congratulations.
<That's right>. I do what I can.
I'm trying.
The Blade's word of the day is...
Instead of flashing up on the screen.
Yeah. So Marlene, she, like you said, she's finished her bout, and maybe she doesn't even say anything. She knows that you've heard what's happened.
Yeah.
And like, you know that she knows that you know. And so she comes over and kind of gives you, she sort of shakes her head and has to reach up almost on her tiptoes to get her hand around the back of your neck and gives you a really long kiss, and then sits down on one of the pallets and, like, massages her face with a damp towel.
When she reaches in to kiss, like, RC, just like to show the difference in their math, like RC reaches around, kind of like gets her like arm like under Marlene's like lumbar and like almost like lifts her up, like lifts her into her, not like picking, not, but there's like, just like pulling her up into her, and then you know, has the ice pack ready there's ice. Absolutely.
Yeah. You could theoretically have ice. That'd be all right.
We got magic, right? Necromancy makes things cold, so we probably have necro ice, right?
Oh god, I love it. Some spirit charm or something like that.
Necro ice.
Well, I could totally, like, you leech heat from stuff. Ice is probably a byproduct of, like, necromancy, right?
I was just waiting
for you to say anything, Strash. I was like, Strash, would you like to fill this gap in?
Yes, I actually have Tempest, so I can generate ice.
Yes. Nice.
It's totally happening. We always have chilled drinks.
Oscar is a walking ice machine.
Okay. I knew we kept you around for some reason, weird boy.
Awesome. Yeah, so you have your moment, and then she says, Cinda and Rafe. She like gives you the names.
Yeah.
She knows that you want to know, and she knows you know what she's talking about, so she just says their names. Go ahead.
Yeah, no. So I nod and I just sort of gesture like, I say, so sounds like I've got a job to do. Can't have that going on. Are you with me? Like, and
she nods like, and smiles. She's like, she was unwinding the wraps on her hands and she starts winding them back on again.
Exactly. And RC's strapped for bear, like she's planning on a pummeling, but she's got a pistol on her side. This gets serious. Like she's not going to be caught off guard. Hopefully it's just a beating.
Nice.
Hopefully it's just a beating.
Oh, beating and threatening with knives over the canal is what I heard.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Definitely knives. And beating, yeah. So, okay.
So how are you gonna find out where these bluecoats sleep? What's your plan here?
I think it takes asking around to find out where it's dusk. They're gonna be either getting off shift or they're gonna be out drinking most likely. So I think it takes asking around where they frequent and then following them from there. So it's a bit of a stakeout at their watering hole, and then wait until they get home.
Because that'll let you get them at the same time, theoretically, right?
Because the home part is important, that they feel that there's threat not only to them but to their family. I'm a horrible person.
Yeah. So far, you're the least horrible member of the crew. So, well, we'll see how long that lasts.
Yeah. Right.
So far.
Depends on how you judge horribleness, but all right.
So it sounds like you are consorting, and you're gonna do a little pub crawl here. You know that this is their beat, like the docks is their beat. So it's a safe bet that they're not at any of the known super dangerous underworld bars because the bluecoats don't go there. So you can rule those out immediately, and then kind of drift in through the rest of the establishments and look for your quarry.
Sounds good.
Cool. So we'll do a roll to see how that goes for you.
All right.
What state you're in when you catch up to these guys. You
hop over to this roll 20 thing to do that
roll. Yeah, do it. Throw those dice.
All right. So I've got one in consort.
Yep. Okay. So you're here.
Show off assembling this pool.
Yeah.
I don't have much stress from my previous. So why not spend the stress?
That's what it's there for.
Be trying to blow that off to. In a moment, anyway. So
yeah.
I'm gonna roll two dice, and I definitely feel like this is ripe for a devil's bargain. If you have anything,
I totally agree.
My own adversity, but if you have anything, I'm.
I totally agree. You know, Oscar told you that Julian, your ex-husband, is looking for you around the docks. He has he has people around hunting for Arsakeel. If you don't talk to anyone you know tonight, you can fly under the radar a little better, but obviously it's not as effective. So my devil's bargain is if Arcee's willing to go to people she knows at these bars, show her face, be like, hey, it's me. Can you help me out here? I'm looking for these blue coats. That'll help your chances because they're more helpful. But the devil's bargain will be that Julian's guys, whoever he has prowling around, will get the message that.
Absolutely. Perfect. I love it. Taking it.
And this is in character too. This is like you, Arcee Keel, you know, this is a risk and you're.
I think Sean jumps on this without hesitation. I think Arcee does this as a realization after she's asked around a few times and she's just like dealt with too many guys that the only reason why they'll talk to her is because they're totally drunk and they're useless. And she's like, fuck, you know, I know that guy over there, but he knows me too. And I think that's sort of a turning point for her in the night as like, she gets more anxious about, well, we got to do this. I don't want to spend forever. You know, like we don't have forever to do this. We got to get it done. So yeah. Arcee makes a choice to reach out to someone that, you know, she hopes will keep his mouth shut, but knows he won't.
Yeah.
So that's cool.
So there's two ways we could do this. It could be you're gathering information and you're in a position where you can just learn stuff and we roll the dice to see like how much you figure out or how much you, like if you were at home studying in a book or something, you know, there's not a lot of risk there. There's not a lot of danger. In this particular case, I think that isn't true. I think,
I don't feel like I'm at home taking it easy.
You and the blue coats are in some ways kind of opposed here. Like they obviously don't want to be waylaid by scoundrels in the night and they're cops and they probably take some measures for that not to happen to them. And you definitely don't want them to turn the tables on you or be in a position where it's going to be hard for you to grab them. So.
Sure.
So it's even though they don't know you're coming yet, it is a little bit of a opposed thing. Like they're their own sort of personal safety methods are going to kick in here.
So, yeah.
Right. So
I assume they don't want what's about to happen to them.
Yeah, exactly.
You don't say. No shit.
So you're consorting, which I think is a perfect way to approach this. In haunts that where people know you and are helpful. But also on their home turf, their beat.
Sure, it's both of our turfs, yeah.
So I feel like we're right in the middle. There's three different positions for people watching at home that you can be in. You can be in a dominant position where everything is kind of stacked in your favor. You can kind of be in a daring position, which is in the middle, where things can go either way. Or you could be in a desperate position where things are stacked against you and the consequences are more severe. But I feel like we're kind of in the middle here. I don't feel like either side has a real big position.
Yeah, I think my advantage on them is I have their names. They don't have mine. They picked up Marlene and they didn't. So they don't know I'm coming for them. But nevertheless, they are still blue coats. So I totally agree. Now, question, the reduce heat move in downtime is sort of like a very compressed, condensed, just roll, and depending on how you roll, it sort of has its own resolution system. Do we want to employ that, or are we going to play it out, you know, rolling? Because it kind of is agnostic to whether or not you're in a dominant, daring, or desperate situation.
Correct, yeah. That roll, how much you reduce your heat will be a separate question. This is purely the grabbing the blue coats and threatening them phase of the operation.
Awesome. I intend to roll then. I'm rolling 3d6. One for my consort, one for the devil's bargain, and one for taking stress.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Oh, there it is.
There we go.
That's nice. The number I wanted to see.
That is very good. So in this game, you roll a pool of d6s and you take the highest single die. So fortunately, Sean managed to grab a six with his three dice.
Yes.
And a six means that he's successful and there's no blowback on Arcee. She doesn't face nasty consequences as a result of this. It goes the way she hoped it would in this case. So if this was like a more significant process, we could get into like how effective she is and if it's going to be like multiple steps to complete this thing and can she do it all in one go or is it going to require like more work or whatever. In this case, this is just a pure like straight up, we're covering the evening in one roll.
So there's no effect level then, it looks like.
There is technically. I didn't say it. It's standard effect, and in this case, right. That means the thing we expect to happen happens.
But there's no questions associated with those, at least on the character sheet anymore.
Yeah, those are on my GM sheet.
Okay, cool.
Moved over to my sheet.
Makes sense. Nice.
So you it goes the way you thought it would. You eventually find a server at one of the pubs. A young man who knows your face and kind of knows you by reputation. She knows you run with some dangerous, or I should say ruthless is your reputation.
Ruthless.
Runs with a ruthless crew in this area and is happy to kind of like be important and step up. And when you drop the names, he says, oh yeah. No, you just missed them. And so you're able to go outside and pick up their trail and follow them.
Nice.
Now, like you said, they don't have any particular reason to be on the lookout for you particularly following them.
Right.
You're in territory that isn't really bad for this. You're not in the really nice part of town where you would stick out like a sore thumb, and you know. So, in other words, the consort role carries you into the ambush, essentially.
Awesome.
There's no new troubles. Eventually. They get to that part of their walk when it looks like one of them is saying, you know, well, you know, I'm going to head up. I'll see you at work tomorrow. They're having that little exchange. You can see the pantomime from a distance.
Right.
It's on a street. They don't live in Crowsfoot. It's just over the bridge. So it's a little bit outside your territory, but it's in Night Market, actually. So it's like, you know, not... it looks a lot like Crowsfoot.
Right. We'll make an exception. We'll spread outside the turf.
Yeah.
It shouldn't piss anybody off.
Technically, you're in some other cruise turf right now, but eh, you know.
All the more opportunity to blame it on them when it goes wrong. It's not going to go wrong because you got a 6, because you're great.
So right. It's you and Marlene. Cyclops and one of his thugs has joined you. Is that true?
Yeah, that's the plan. The idea was once we could. I mean, assuming we have the ability to coordinate this.
Yeah, totally, yeah.
We definitely want to use overpowering force. So that there's no dispute or a question. It's not like there's a need, like not like any one of us couldn't kick their ass. It's to show that there's a lot of us and we'll find them. And
RC has specific skills. You don't know who they are, don't know where they are, but you'll find them.
Yeah, right. This is my town. This is my home. Don't fuck with me. My people. Cool.
So you're going to rush him on the street? Is that the idea? Grab him and drag him into an alleyway or something like that?
I think it's not quite pulling him out of their beds, but it'll do. Because
as you could.
No, I think we don't have the sort of level of reconnaissance to A, split up and follow them.
Yeah, you don't want to go full Nazgul on these guys.
Right, well, exactly. So that's perfect. This is close enough. When one of them gestures to, you know, like, I'm going that way. Like, that's adequate enough for us to go, okay, he lives right around there. It's close. And yeah, we jump them in the alley. It starts with a clobbering, because we're not going to talk to them. We're going to talk to them after they're incapacitated. So
it's clobbering time.
Yeah.
All right, nice. So this is going to be a straight-up skirmish.
Awesome.
Pretty standard.
I'm good at that.
Good.
I have special skills.
That's what I'm saying.
yeah. So... You start with 2 dice in skirmishing. You outnumber them, and it's a surprise attack. I think you're in a dominant position for this, and because you outnumber them, you can go for great effect. You could try to just like pin them, like capture or incapacitate them in one go here. Of course, they're gonna fight back, but
that sounds great.
You have every advantage.
Awesome.
This situation. So, So dominant position and great effect. You have perfect. Two dice currently.
I'm gonna roll my 2 dice.
Do it.
Okay, well, there's a 5.
You're a 6.
5, alright.
Pretty good.
Okay. So, that means you do it, but there's a consequence. So, I think... So I choose from my list here, or I can make something out, but it can take extra time, you have a reduced effect, you end up in a daring position instead of your dominant position you currently hold. I feel like that's where I want to go here, so...
Yeah,
Marlene,
I feel like time is not really a shortage right now, so...
Yeah, Marlene sense. And the thugs, like, rush in. Marlene, like, punches one of them in the back of the neck and, like,
yeah.
doubles him over, and he's all, like, wobbly on his feet. Cyclops punches it's Rafe, like, punches Rafe in the gut, and doubles him over, and the other thug, like, grabs the guy by the collar and hauls him into the shadows of the alleyway.
Nice.
Cinda ducks away from Marlene's follow-up hook, and it, like, catches her on the shoulder. And as you come forward, she gets her truncheon out.
Yeah.
And whips it at your head.
Goddamn truncheons.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you can tell, like, she's not trying to get you. She's trying to, like, force you back so she can just run, presumably to the, like, nearest call, alarm bell or something.
So I've got, like, my hand, like, sitting next to my knife, but it's not going to help here. So instead, I just sort of turn my shoulder and charge into her so I get inside of her range. I want to outspeed her and slam into her so knock sort of, you know, so she can't knock me back, and I get inside of her.
Instead of dodging away, you just close the distance real fast.
Exactly, and if that means taking like getting clobbered in the process, that's fine. Like I didn't expect to walk out of this without getting hurt.
Nice. Okay, so make a follow-up skirmish roll here.
Okay.
It's daring instead of dominant this time. You have two dice still again, unless you want to bump it up.
Oh. What the hell? I want a reason to blow a lot of... To really need to indulge my vice, so... take two more stress on that. Make that 3-6.
Nice. Oh, yeah.
Oh, there you go.
Dice are on fire. Nice.
Yeah, that's what we wanted.
Yeah, so, yeah, she doesn't even connect. You duck right under, and you even get, like, kind of catch under her armpit with her arm behind your head here, so you can kind of do the head and arm choke a little bit on her and drag her sideways. And with that move, you and the thugs carry both of them into the darkness of the alley. Marlene, like, gets her in a hold and puts her hand over her mouth so you can step back to say what you got to say, you know.
Nice.
And they're pinned down. They're kind of wide eyed. They don't know what's gonna happen next, right? Like you're here to kill them, as far as they know.
Right. Well, that's the look that we want in their eyes. That's the right effect. So, and this is possibly going to. This is possibly going to bite her back, bite her in the future using this. But RC pulls out her fine hand weapon, which is a military saber that
damn girl
issued to her, and so she can stand, you know, a good arm and a half's length away from them and still hold this blade to their throat. Which is what she's gonna do to Cinda, because Cinda and her have now had the scuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And tell her in RC looks and says, "I've heard you've been asking around. It's a really bad idea. It's a really bad idea for you, and it's a really bad idea for your family. Night Market isn't a safe place. There's bad people in Night Market. There's bad people like my friends who really should have a reason not to hurt you or your own. Why don't you give us a good reason so bad things don't have to happen to you?"
And nice. your threats are so much more coherent than Cantor's would be. That mine would just be a lot of shouting and grabbing my crotch. I mean, like, what? What? So good on you, RC. You're the woman for the job.
Thanks.
Not me.
Got some skills.
Yeah, so they're wide-eyed and kind of shaking. Marlene, like, slowly takes her hand off of Cinda's mouth, and she's like, Yeah, whatever you want. I mean, can you tell us what this is about? We don't want to make mistakes, right, Rafe? And Rafe is like shaking his head. He's like, no, we don't want to make mistakes. She's like, are you with the Red Sashes? She kind of looks you up and down. You're not wearing any Red Sashes. Mm-hmm.
Right. I think this is when... Yeah, I think in order to stay anonymous, I need to tell them who I am, because they need to know who to stay away from. And also, we need to spread the word of our name. So,
no. If you're reducing heat, they need to know who to stay, right?
Yeah. Right. I'm like, no, we're the Six Towers gang.
You see, like...
Right.
No recognition in her eyes at all.
This would be the point where I would just shoot her and be like, so insulted, but...
Yeah, exactly.
But then Rafe like, mumbles something, and Cyclops moves his hand away, and Rafe's like, the tattoo parlor. And he has this, he's gone really pale.
Yeah. Don't look around there anymore. That's not on your beat anymore, as of now. Your beat no longer includes that area. Or any area really close to it.
He looks really nervous, and like looks really pointedly at Cinda, and she's like glaring back at him, and they have this little bit of an exchange, and she's finally like, it's in my wallet, and Marlene like, you know, goes through her coat and pulls out her badge and pulls out this like folded leather like document holder, and it's got a bunch of blue coat paperwork in it, like wanted sheets and stuff.
Yeah.
And Marlene's like rifling through, and she stops and looks up at you and flips it around.
Yeah.
And it's this really nice portrait of R.C. Keel.
Nice.
It's not a wanted poster like they pin up in the city. It's like a, I guess it'd be a bolo in our world. Like, be on the lookout for.
Yeah, totally.
Issued by the Keel, Lord Keel, da 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 da. You know, information leading to da, blah 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 blah. There's a reward and contact information and stuff. It doesn't look like you look now. It's like someone's recollection of you back before you left.
Is. It's adorable.
Yeah. So she like folds it up and passes it over to you.
Yeah.
And Cinda's like, okay, we won't bother you ever again. I promise.
Word.
But I'm not in charge of those papers.
It's all right. Take care of the papers.
Okay. If you seem reasonable and not like psychopath with a saber, then she relaxes.
It's a fine line between the two.
I mean, it is still like resting on her shoulder. Like the blade is like still like there where...
But she gets the message here that you're doing business. Like,
yeah.
we want something. Don't mess with us. We can get to you. But not like, hey, yeah, cop, we're going to have some fun now. Like, there's nothing. Right. There's none of that going on. Right?
No. There's no desire to torture at all.
Okay. I mean,
that's why you do this alone, because it would have gotten way out of hand otherwise.
So they relax, and they realize, because this has probably happened, something like this happens every now and then to people in their position. And now that they know it's just business, they're like, okay,
It's
deal. The monthly shakedown.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Instead of you paying them off to look the other way, you threaten them to look the other way. It's you know, whatever. Right. They would rather just, they'd rather be paid off.
But, just more economical. It's fine.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if they are of the means to negotiate, like, we could certainly start getting blue coats on our payroll. But I don't think
I don't want to fuck with that shit. We gotta have a conversation about this.
I don't think this is the conversation to have.
It's
that
the way of the world.
That's later on down the road. That's our next interaction is when we start leaning on them for not just not doing their job, but for helping us. That's when money, I think, starts changing hands. So
yeah,
I'm fine with this understanding that we have right now. We can advance that in time. We'll see how that goes. So cool. I'm good. Do you want me to roll to get rid of heat, or do you want?
Yeah, let's go ahead and see how much heat reduction you get out of that little.
Cool. And the reason why I brought Cyclops, mechanically speaking, was I intend to spend coin to up this. So my idea is like I gotta pay off my guys. Like,
yep.
You know, it's not just me doing this. It's and I also got to like make sure Marlene's compensated for. So
nice, yeah.
Cool. When we roll the heat, I'm gonna spend the coin needed to bump that up. So I think I roll my tier to reduce heat, and our tier is currently zero.
It is currently zero. Yes.
Right.
Have fun with your no dice.
Roll two and take the lower number.
Yeah, that's fine. I'm gonna buy this roll with coin.
Yeah, exactly. This is just to see if you get lucky.
Well, lower of the two of them.
take the three. All right. Well, we have two heat right now, and yeah. A one to three reduces one. So I'm gonna say I'm spending that coin. Hope you guys don't mind. To reduce two heat.
That'll get rid of all your heat.
We'll be down to zero heat.
Yep. Cool.
And so theoretically that could have been used to pay off the blue coats, but I'd much rather be giving that to our people.
Yeah, word.
And it's also protection, makes sense. Nice.
Yeah, totally. Cool. Okay, so let's cut away there. I know you have another thing to do, but let's...
No, that's perfect. I'm very happy.
Switch up to the next character there. Just to wrap that up in brief, like, once they know it's a deal, they agree, and, you know, you let them go. They wander off. You guys slip away back across the bridge, and that's the end of that.
Yeah.
No shenanigans.
Nope.
Okay. Who's up next? Who has a thing they want to do?
Well, I mean, looking at Oscar's character sheet, I see all kinds of pies up in there, so... Would you like to go next, creepy?
I like also
that you have your familiar lurking about
know,
your
right?
shoulders.
Yeah, Nemo, he's a gamer cat. He loves just chilling whenever I'm playing games. But, here's the question. Whenever you guys are done, I'm going to burn through a bunch of our coin because it lets me work through projects, and I definitely want to finish at least the weird tattoo inks. So, do you want to go at them and see what you need, or do you want to... Let me be super.
Yeah, I mean, I think my stuff as Cantor goes is going to be pretty straightforward. I want to do the things that are going to get me the most like money. So maybe I should go first.
Do it.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Cool. So I got to pick one of these downtime things.
That is, those are things you can pick,
yeah.
or you can tell me you want to do a thing. This is the menu, but you can order off the menu.
Right, okay, cool. Yeah, I mean, I think that, like, after brokering that deal with a vampire, I mean, the vampire part is just kind of like, whatever, like, he might as well just be, like, a person from some other country, like, I don't really care that he's, like, a vampire, because, whatever, the deal's the deal. So I think, Cantor, like, what I'll probably end up doing is indulging my vice, like, either going out and, like, getting fancy, or acquiring an asset for future fanciness. Like, I'm gonna, like, I don't know, I think it might not be time for the full-blown party yet. I think we've just made our first steps towards getting up in the world.
Yeah.
So something that I can do to like start to prepare for that next step, to like keep making the organization bigger, bring on any new like crew we might need, that kind of stuff. Like I'm thinking long-term infrastructure shit, not just like individual problems.
Yeah, totally. There's a few assets you might look into. You could skip ahead to hiring a tattoo artist if you want to go that direction.
Yeah, maybe that's something that Oscar and I like talked about, and we're like, okay, you do all the magic voodoo stuff you do, because I don't have any idea how that works. But, you know, I got people skills. Cantor's got people skills. I'm gonna go out there and work the streets. We'll try to find the like, yeah, somebody who can we can apply to our magical tattooing plans.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay. Yeah. Let's do that.
Cool. Okay. All right. So, what's your first step in acquiring a tattooist who you can lie to and not say what they're really doing, or who's willing to?
Right. So that's the thing. So what are tattoos like? Let's talk about. Let's get game mastery here for a second, John. So what like culturally are tattoos the province of like sailors and criminals? Is that the jam? Like you get them in prison and like maybe like tough military dudes have tattoos because they're in a unit or whatever. It's not like Has there ever been a cultural like thing where like rich people got tattoos, or is it just still strictly very like lower class tough guy stuff?
It is mainly lower class stuff. In Akeros, anyway,
I hear the Aruvians have a lot of very fancy tattoos.
Yeah, so that's what I kind of want to know. Yeah.
It's kind of like the way I picture the 19th century English kind of thing, like sailors and travelers went out and discovered these cool things and brought some of that back home. So it's not really native to Duskwall and
sure.
to Akeros itself, but in the north, in Skovlan, tattoos are a big thing. They're mostly like, you know, like what you would expect, like this kind of Norse Scottish.
Yeah.
Thing.
So who's our closest? Because I want to go after somebody who's like for whom tattooing is like a cultural, like already a thing.
Yeah.
But I don't want them to be like the same culture as any of our close enemies, right? Like if we have a Skovlander gang that's trying to fuck us up, I don't want to be like, yes, no, Skovlander tattoo guy, come work for us, because they'll just get flipped easy.
Right. No. You're right now the Lampblacks and the Red Sashes are having their turf war. You right. are you're squatting in one of the Lampblacks.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Territories. The Red Sashes had the tattoo parlor before you. They're mostly Aruvians from the south. Mm-hmm. They're duelists and they're also big into the drug trade.
Yeah.
And then the Lampblacks are local Akerosi.
Okay.
Kind of typical. Irishy English street gang with top hats and canes and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
So the Skovlanders, they just as a bit of a background, like they are the last to join the Empire. The war in Skovlan just ended 2 years ago. There's Skovlan refugees and military people still in the city, and a lot of them are hooked up in the criminal underworld.
Perfect.
So yeah, those you probably have heard of a Skovlander, like soldier or merchant marine type person who is a tattooer in Crow's Foot.
Yeah, that's who I'm going after. I want to find somebody who can do that. Yeah.
Cool. All right. Let me dig up a name for this person. Where's my names? They're there.
Yeah, I mean the first stage in the plan is finding somebody that'll do these tattoos, but then like that whole like, you know, trying to get rich people to think tattoos are cool, that's phase two. We're gonna
also,
culturally get out there.
You have really good taste, or at least you aspire to have really
good
taste.
Yeah, I do. I know.
So I think finding somebody that might have artistic
exactly.
merit is definitely up your alley.
Totally. Yeah, yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So, yeah, this guy's name is Brogan.
Okay.
He does not have a boutique or a salon or whatever you call a tattoo parlor. He is... he fought in the war. This is just what you know on the street, right?
Sure.
You've seen a kind of upswing in some very traditional, old Norse style tattooing.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
The current tattoos in Duskwall are very sort of whale hunting era England. A lot of scroll work and ropes and bones and skulls and things.
Thug life.
Yeah.
Skilled. Yeah, all right. I got some of those probably.
But the Skovlan style is geometric. You know, it's these kind of like stylized hammers or spears or that kind of stuff.
So I think, I think that I would use like my own personal resources or whatever to get a like an appointment with this dude and get a tattoo mm-hmm. from him and use that as an opportunity to be like, hey man, I got a business proposition for you, while he's like hammering, chiseling away the ink into me.
Yeah, totally. He's old school. He has the old like tapping. Stick and everything. The electric tattoo gun, I think, exists in this universe. I think you guys have one or two at the place, but or a foot pedal version. Have the foot pedal version at this point.
Yeah, like an old timey sewing machine, right? Like you just keep the wheel spinning and it keeps the needle.
Electricity in your part of the city is a little iffy.
We'll talk about upgrades later.
Yeah. Right. So you can get in to see this guy, Brogan, and he's a wiry. Lean dude. He's older. He's probably 60-ish. Sweet. He has a gray beard, like kind of close cropped gray beard and cropped sort of military looking hair. He's got scars. His hands are like baseball gloves. You know, they're just these like calloused mitts. He's all knobby and
sweet. And is he just like blue with like faded old tattoos?
Oh man,
fucking, I love that shit.
He is fucking covered. He doesn't wear a shirt. He wears like RC would be familiar. He wears these like little like a loincloth kind of like sailors wear sometimes at sea. In the north, it's like a thing because it's like cold and icy up there, and sailors like prove their man or womanhood by like wearing as little as they can and clambering around on the frozen ropes and shit.
Somebody in chat made the great suggestion that he's built like Iggy Pop.
Yeah, totally. He's totally Iggy Pop. I just saw
Rad.
That.
So in.
Yeah.
Cool.
He's just, it's, somebody's leaving and he waves you in. He has a bottle of whiskey next to the table, and some glasses lying around for customers and for himself as he goes. He's probably a bottle and a half in at this point in the day, and now so now he's really in the zone.
Totally.
He looks up and he's like, "What can I do for you?"
I guess I like look around at the stuff that he's got, and I'm like, just looking to get inked, man.
Come to the right place. Sort of gestures at the he has a fairly nice couch. It's not a tattooing like dentist chair, but it's nice. Like it's really clean and sort of plush. It's this really nice sofa thing.
Cool. Okay. So I like very like carefully hang up my like nice coat and hat, and then take my shirt off, and you can see my like prison tattoos or whatever in the like old the style of the time. And I'll sit down.
Yeah, just out of question, Adam, are they kind of amateurish and sloppy, or are they kind of cool prison tattoos?
I think that they're a little of both. It really depends. Like, there's definitely some drunken stick and poke going on.
Okay.
But also, like, maybe a few, like, decent ones.
Are you pretty well covered, or do you have good...
No, it's just kind of getting started. Just a few.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Yeah, so I'll sit down and be like, "Yeah, I heard you were the best." So,
no, you didn't.
Like, I'm gonna be like, "So what? There's somebody better? Should I just put my stuff back on and go give them my money, or what?" Yeah, so I thought, let's do it. Come on, and I'll point at the tattoos that I've already got and be like, "Yeah, I picked most of these off of like a." out of a book, but I figured I'd just kind of let you do your thing. Oh, we lost our GM.
We lost.
Bye, John. See you later. I guess I'll never get that tattoo.
Who knows?
I'll never be cool.
I thought that was
tattoo
just like...
denial.
I know. I thought he was giving me Stonewall there.
Yeah, exactly. Just like, oh, fuck you. I thought he was really holding that. Cool.
I know. I was impressed.
I'm back. Oh, I'm back.
All right.
Back, but we don't have video.
That's
well,
okay.
Wait.
Get that.
Are we? No. Yes.
Spinny. There we go. We got you.
All right. Skype, everybody.
It was funny. You disappeared, and we were like, "Man, harsh Stonewall, John." I'm just like, "Oh, just."
Because it's like drinking your hand, and you were just like, "Fuck you." No reaction.
Oh man, you're harsh, John. Shit.
All right, what did I miss? What did you say?
I just said I was like, well, let's like, I said I thought, you know, I heard you were the best, and you're like, no, you didn't. And then I thought you were stonewalling me, so I was like, I said, well, if there's somebody better, like, I'll take my business elsewhere.
Yeah, he chuckles at what is a joke, I guess.
Yeah, for sure. It's hard to tell with Cantor.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't think Cantor knows most of the time.
Cantor's sense of humor.
Yeah.
He comes over and he like manhandles you a little bit. He like turns you around and like looks for a good spot. And he like slaps your side or your rib cage. He's like, "That'll do nicely." And then leads you over and like positions you where he wants on the couch. He doesn't ask you what you want unless you really want to say something.
Fuck no, man. This is not that kind of tattoo. I'm just like, I want a tattoo and you are...
He knows the tattoo you are supposed to have.
You're a cool tough guy. And this is how you get a tattoo of a giant penis on you.
Yeah, that's right.
This man is a moron. So I'm just like, yeah, just do your thing. And I think that over the course of however long the tattoo takes, I just try to, like, figure the angle on this dude and, like, see kind of, like, you know, how's business and, like, you want to... I try to, like, kind of lure him into a conversation of, getting up in the world and doing something, like, new, something different, right? And I think that's the tack that I take. Not, like, we're going to shower you in money. I'm like, I know you're an artist and you're looking for, like, the next big thing. You want to get known, right? So... You know, we got this opportunity for you. We got some weird new shit you could try out. And I want to lean him in that direction rather than try to, like, woo him with the fat ducats we don't have.
So do you want to try to get a read on him before you make the pitch? Like, how much you might be able to tell him?
Yeah, because I think I've done some like, street work on this already, so.
Sure, yeah. Yeah, you know, by reputation, he's like a no-nonsense dude who doesn't talk about himself and went through some shit in the war, and that's all people really know.
Mm-hmm.
So, if you want to get a read and see, it sounds like
all right.
The thing you're doing.
What am I rolling?
So, in this case, I think, you have a choice of how you handle it. You can consort if that's what you're doing, if you're like... kind of sharing your own stories and getting him to talk back and sort of like being a kind of charming conversationalist, or you can study him and just like, you know, try to pick up on his mannerisms.
I have a die in one of those and not in the other. So I'm definitely going to, I'm going to study him for sure.
Okay. All right. So you don't really talk a whole lot. You just kind of try to get a read on what kind of guy he is by how he acts and says. Yeah, cool.
Yeah.
So, this
but
is
it's really
the...
throughout the whole process, it's really important that Cantor doesn't come off like a wimp. Like I like, even if it hurts really bad, which I'm sure it does, it's like almost more important than the deal going well that this guy think that I'm tough. Like it's a huge fucking deal. Like I don't. That's the first thing, and then all this other shit is secondary. So, yeah.
Nice. Yeah. Glad to see where Cantor's priorities are.
Hey, I don't look like a wuss. All right.
Nice. So this role will be like getting a read on him, but it'll also be informing you on how to act so he thinks you're cool.
Basically. Sure. Yeah, totally. Okay.
Yeah, nice.
Cool. So I just roll my study?
You're just going to roll unless you want to push and get extra dice and stuff. And this will tell us how... There's no risk here. It's just like how much. How
sure.
much do you...
Yeah, yeah. So I won't push it too hard. Right. So let's see what we get here. This is my actual roll. Bloop. Aw, damn.
Oh,
yeah. Word.
Good at role-playing games, Adam.
Super good. Yep.
Knows how to do it.
Mm-hmm. Also works for roll 20 and roll sixes. I mean,
yeah,
I'm just saying, right? It's a
like, I used to roll really bad, but now just this, just so good at this game.
Why would you have a roll a six now, macro?
Seriously, it's weird.
Yeah, I don't know.
All right, so with the six, I'm paying close attention to like. I've done the hustle thing before, right? Like, it's no different than convincing someone to, like, buy more drugs than they wanted to, or convince someone who's trying to, like, you know, get off the shit to, like, get back in. I'm really good at that. So, you know, I think I'm probably pretty good at, like, figuring the angles on people.
Yeah, totally. And you're there for a couple hours and get through most of that bottle. He doesn't say much as he goes, but he does kind of chuckle under his breath at one point and point at one of your prison tats that has something to do with, I don't know what it is, but it reminds him of a story. And now that he's fairly well into the whiskey, he tells this brief story about being lost at sea. And when they had to resort to cannibalism.
Nice.
He tells it in this flat monotone, and you can tell in that moment, like, oh man, he must really think I'm a hard case like him. Like, he's not trying to impress me, or he's not trying to tell me a weird story. He's just telling me, like, out at sea, when it's cold and wet, and you got no other choice, you gotta do what you gotta do. You know, and he's not trying to be cool in front of you,
yeah.
And he doesn't think You know what I mean? Like, it's just this safe space of somebody else who gets it.
That's right.
You know, about a hard life and how
exactly
you don't get what you want, and you just got to fight for everything. And he's a survivor. And, you know, you just kind of bond over this.
Totally. It's all bullshit on my end, but I'm like, yeah, totally. Word, yeah. Word. You got to, sometimes you just got to eat a man alive.
That's right.
Like, blood and stuff? Yeah, whatever. I don't give a shit about that. I'm tough and stuff. Whatever.
Right. Hey, but you get a good enough read on him so you don't, like, overdo it. You know, you're not like, yeah, what?
Sure. Yeah, yeah. Overdoing
eat,
it.
I could eat 10 guys.
Yeah, I'd eat that guy right now. Fuck it. Let's do it. Let's kill and eat that guy. Yeah, no.
I'll eat you.
Yeah, exactly. All right, cool.
You play it off cool, and you get a good read that this guy, he doesn't have a lot of lines. He's crossed all his lines a long time ago. There's kind of nothing that's going to phase him or be too far for him.
That's what we want. We want people that aren't.
That's what you're looking for.
Yeah, I want someone that when I'm like, yeah, you want to go and like jam some demon blood into some people? He'll be like, all right, I ate a man. What? This is nothing. This is fucking shit. All right. Cool.
He ends every story with, I also ate a man.
Also, though, I killed and ate a man. It's fine. Yep.
Nice. Okay.
Okay.
So. You want to make the pitch now. You want to see if he'll...
Yeah, totally.
Over. Are you looking to land him as a freelancer, or do you want him to, like, come work for us now?
I mean, I will do one and then the other, right? I want to like, trial run him, right? I want to be like, yeah. I got this opportunity. We've got some special ink, and I got a whisper. He's doing some cool stuff. So if you want to try, like, a different venue for your tattoos, like, you know, we're looking for an artist. So cool. let's try to get him on that angle.
Wire asset is are you going to tell him about the unique opportunity using demon blood as tattoo ink?
I think I'm going to like dangle the carrot a little. I'm not going to straight up be like, it's demon blood, check it out. I'm going to be like, you know, unique medium for his art, and we'll let his imagination lure him the rest of the way in.
Nice.
Yeah.
All right.
Cool. All right, what do I need to roll here? I got a dot and sway.
So when it comes to money, you gotta talk crew tier, because that's your buying.
That's right. That's the thing for the acquire asset. Okay.
Yeah. Now you've already got a relationship here, so you're definitely gonna get him. Like, he's not gonna turn you down.
Sure. It'll just be how well it goes.
How well, like, kind of how much it's gonna potentially cost you to get what you want out of this guy. Is he going to come in on spec for nothing, or is he going to, do a shitty job because you're not paying him, or are you going to have to offer him some money? That's what we're going to find out.
Yeah, for sure. Okay.
What you know for sure, based on your little study session with him, is that, like, he's not the type of guy who's going to talk to the blue coats. He's not going to, you know.
Yeah,
you're totally solid in that regard.
Because, you know, if he did, I'd be like, this guy ate a man. You got a one, Strash. That demo roll. You failed. Sorry.
Sorry, I was just testing it out. Carry on.
I was like, "What?"
Yeah, get those ones out of the way. That's cool. Yeah. It's fine. Oh,
that's
going
to do it.
Okay. All right. So our tier is what? We're still tier zero.
You're still zero. Yeah. So.
Yeah. Bullshit. Hey, you control two dice then.
Oh, good. I got two dice. Fantastic. Two. Maybe they'll both be threes like before. All right.
Hey, listen up. After the job tonight, we's gonna be tier one. So.
Yeah.
All right. Rolling 2d6.
Three was good enough last time.
I got four.
Hey, that's actually all right.
Yeah.
So what that means is you can get him to come in and do standard tattoo work for you. You don't have to give him any money up front right now. If you want him to come in and start doing his best work, you could drop a coin right now and bump him up.
We'll start here. Let him get him hooked on the idea of doing like cool magic tattoos. Then when we have some more money, we can integrate him more directly into the gang.
Cool. All right. Yeah. So he's not gonna go out of his way to create new redefine tattooing in Duskwall. He's just gonna
he's gonna do
his standard work.
And
there'll be a little bit of money changing hands, but it's not enough to ding the crew's reserves. You don't have to dig into your coffers yet. Yeah. Cool. All right, so that's all set up, and you get a cool tattoo. What is it? I wonder. It's some kind of stylized creature or weapon or something like that, probably. I think, because of his mindset right then, he was thinking of, it's like a storm cloud, I think. Like a this
it's
kind
just,
of...
It's just like a sweet tattoo of a dude eating another dude.
It's a storm cloud eating another storm cloud.
It's like, we were having this conversation about cannibalism. I don't know, I can't.
Yeah, it's
the hand that's like had the fingers not off.
Oh, man. Oh, yeah, maybe that's what it is. It's like a skeletal...
Like a hand of glory?
Yeah, maybe.
I'm into it.
Yeah? Yes. All right. Yeah, that's cool. Kind of like, kind of grabbing your...
Yeah, I think it's grabbing your ribs. I think it's like...
Bony fingers.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool.
Sweet.
Nice. All right, Brogan the Tattooist acquired. Let's work. Okay, now for you, Strosh, let's cut over and see what your first bit of...
Oh, my first, second, and third.
Is.
It's all going to be long-term projects, man.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's all I got.
Toiling away.
Yeah, work on that pie.
Yep.
So, how are you doing for stress? You don't need any stress relief? You're good?
Nah, I'm zeroed, actually.
Oof, nice.
I've been clean for a while.
Nice.
So are you, you're back at the manor house, working? Is that
okay? Yeah, I think there's like, I think Oscar is definitely setting up. We didn't buy a workshop, so we don't have like a full-fledged workshop, but
no.
I think that there's definitely some rooms in the basement that have like, maybe as you guys are like chilling around the manor house discussing business or whatever, every once in a while you see Oscar just like trumping through and he's carrying like big chains with like manacles over one shoulder and he's kind of humming.
That's Oscar. Speaking of which, what crew upgrade did we want? Because we were talking about a couple on email and we haven't, I don't think we selected one. Did we want to pick that or do we want to just decide later on when it comes up?
You could have it now if you want to add something now.
If you want to add something, like, I don't know, a workshop. Just as a...
I don't have Tinker yet, so I think this is going to be a makeshift workshop. It's not, like, full-on. So I think that there's probably going to be, like... So there's two big projects that I'm working on. One is from episode one. I'm still studying some whisper secrets from Silver, who used to be one of our... rivals from the Lampreys, but we nixed her and she somehow survived ghost destruction. So
yeah.
I was very interested in that and she's bound. And so
you murdered her and all of her friends is what happened.
And the way that I learned that is kind of creepifying because what I'm gonna do is like Oscar spends like an afternoon just like drawing like massive amounts of circles on the ground and things like that to like make sure that, you know, he's got some protection from this, and then just like sits down in the middle of it and brings her out, you know, is totally like, I'm ready. And she just, like, possesses him. And he, like, sits there and, like tries to merge the knowledge out of the ghost.
okay.
Like you do.
Yeah.
You are a mess, man. You got issues.
Wow.
My vice is weird. I will point that out, so.
Yep.
yeah. So that's a thing you're doing.
That's totally a project I'm doing.
Yeah.
The other thing that's happening, and this is, I'm probably going to spend coin to get multiple passes at this, is Oscar actually takes a lot of time sort of running over to Quellen's and being like, try these things. And, you know, he's like studying, he's like flipping through books, and occasionally he's doing like meditations and communing with Zatara, and he's like trying to figure out what to do, and he's like mixing some of the like night black waters of the Never Sea, you know, into this stuff, and like pigments, weird pigments and stuff. And so, he keeps getting batches, and then he's like, I need to test this. So he's trying to refine the process to make the tattoo inks. And I think that that project's going to be pretty simple. He's essentially going to go down to where people are buying from our tattoo parlor and basically be like, who wants to volunteer for free drugs?
Volunteer for free drugs. I love it.
What happened is he asked to enter because he's like, I went down there and I asked, but my mask crawled out and everybody ran away. So can you just... see if somebody wants to be guinea pigs. So that's it. Those are, like, I'm literally, like, staying up nights and you know, napping during the day for brief amounts of time, and I'm just, like, working my teenage witch butt off here, so.
Cool. Let's start with one of those, whichever one you want to do first.
So you know what? I want to see how far I get along, because I need to know how the coin's going to get spent. So I'm going to go for the tattoo ink research first.
Okay. So you're spending time down at the parlor, with Quellen. She's down there too, working.
I'm gonna guess that her shop is actually somewhere else. Like, she's an independent person.
Yeah.
She's working with us, but she's not necessarily living in the tower yet because we don't have a workshop and stuff.
Right.
So I think, like, I'll probably go over and get the batch and then do my research, and then in the morning leave notes for the batch for the next night, and then crash, wake up, pick up the next batch, do it again.
Yeah, okay, cool. Nice. So the fine thugs are doing a much better job. They've cleaned up the front room, so it looks somewhat like a tattoo parlor that's closed down and boarded up. They have the drug stash on site, and they have the money in another area down the alleyway. And people sort of queue up it down in the alley and pass the money in, and then they go in and get the injection down in the murder basement.
Wait.
I like that it's officially called that now.
Yeah, you know.
I guess we did murder a bunch of people in the basement.
You did, yeah.
All right, yeah. I was thinking of all the half demon, the 10% demons, but they weren't murdered.
The original people who ran this place, the Red Sashes, they got murdered by the Lamp Blacks. Then somebody came in to look at their dead bodies, and you murdered those people.
Right.
And then the room was filled with slowly dying.
It's the circle of life. People. Just sometimes people gotta get iced.
I think murder hole would just be.
Down in the, I think that's a Tom Waits song, isn't it?
Down in the murder hole, yeah.
So they have a little bit of a system now where Cyclops has figured out kind of how to tell when someone's going to go bad. So when that looks like that's going to happen, they hold him back. And when it's not, they're like, get out of here. So they have this nice system now where they kind of have this assembly line for Lord Skurlock's needs in the future. It's really bad. It's horrible.
You're fucking awful individuals.
Yeah. So that's my way of saying you have all the opportunity to select test subjects or whatever it is that you need for your
that's
awful
pretty much exactly it.
Black magic nonsense.
Yeah, lovely.
So yeah, this is purely just a project clock. We're like, you're not in a particular danger at this point. This particular thing you're doing right now is fairly straightforward, actually. So,
I'm sticking to my strengths. So,
yeah.
All right. Let me know.
Let's see how it goes. So you're gonna roll something.
Well, I'm doing magical research.
Yeah.
So the question here is, am I trying to ascertain the effects of it, engage the purity and the changes with magic, which will probably be a tune, or am I doing research, in which case it's a type of study? Right. I am better at one and the other, but I'm asking you, so.
It's up to you how you approach it, if you want
to. Let's add a little bit of creepy, because that's like, you know, my calling card, like you do. So I think there's probably definitely times where, you know, I take the substance and, like, when it's mixed up, I'll inject it into someone. And then there's this moment where, like, somebody's just sitting there, you know, like, held up. And Oscar, like, leans in and flexes his hands out and then just bends it into shape into, like, different tattoos. Like, literally, it's almost like he's communing or controlling the ink and trying to make it, like, go in specific ways. And so sometimes it, like, rebels and, like, it might even, like, lift itself off the skin. He's like, nope, bad batch. We need to fix that. So.
Okay, nice. Once again, Cyclops and his guys are reminded of who they have thrown in with.
Yeah.
And they try really hard not to pay too close attention to what's happening. But well, like, you know, they're Leviathan hunter sailors. They're not.
They're telling stories that one of them
fragile. Yeah, they're not fragile types, but they're definitely freaked out.
They're also enterprising, if we remember from the very first.
They are looking to see how they can take this business away from you, but they haven't yet figured out a way. And when they see stuff like this, they're like, I don't know.
Like, can't do that.
I'm not sure.
All right. Well, I'm going to roll, and we're going to see how it comes out.
All right, 5.
2 segments.
So, yeah, so you... How many did we say that was? Is it 6?
Yes. Oh, well, actually... They're all identical clocks. This one looks like it has 8, but I don't. I think so. Maybe it is 8, right?
Oh, maybe. Let me look. Oh yeah, it is 8 actually.
Okay. In which case, since we're taking like 2 actions, is it okay if I just spend my second action doing the same thing?
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, you're basically there day and night most of the week doing this, and let's see how far you get. Hey, that's good. So that's 3. So you're 5/8 of the way through the tattoo ink problem.
So here's the question. We had 5 coin. We had to spend 1 immediately, and I know Arcee spent 1. And I know Cantor spent 1. So I'm going to ask the gang.
No, Cantor didn't.
Oh, Cantor did not? Okay,
so
cool.
We have 4 coin right now.
All right, so do you guys mind if I burn another 1 or 2 coin on this?
You nerds, man, eating up my money.
Well, actually, let's be worried about your money. Keep in mind that this is essentially improving both our outputs and increasing the possibility of our clientele. And
I think Oscar should do it and then have to explain it.
Yeah, I mean, I think you should do it anyway. But like, Cantor's not about this future investment and bullshit. You're using my money right now.
Where like it's getting better, and then at one point, like the tattoo starts like crawling up the person. It's in his face. And he's screaming, and I just get frustrated. And I'm just like, no, we need better quality ingredients. And there's like 1/4 of our funds are gone. Like you just walk into like the bank and like a chunk of the coin is missing. And I'm just doing it.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, just blow it. I didn't ask you guys. I just paid off people I needed to get the thing I needed done.
So the correct answer is I spend 2 coin. I'm going to get 2 from that roll, and I'm just going to spend 1 to buy the last tick and call this research done.
Yeah.
That's so you're leaving 2 coin in the crew coffers?
That is correct.
All right.
I'll work on my own personal project a little bit later. But I think there's just this moment where, like Oscar shows up and he's got like this like really nice, it's old because everything in Skurlock Mansion is antique and he's obviously repurposed it, but he shows up. And he's, like, got, like, bags under his eyes, and he's just, like, exhausted. He's even paler than usual. And he just sets this thing down, and he opens it. And there's, like, shimmering greens and violets and ink black ones and all sorts of colors that are, like, really vivid and kind of gorgeous. Like, reds that almost glow. And he says, it's done.
Nice.
If you ever look like a homeless waif.
Yes, I totally do.
Yeah.
This is your Kate Moss moment?
Yeah.
Yes, it is. So yeah, I think I just...
So this is even better. This isn't just that you have the inks now. You've actually created a system to make them.
Yep.
And you'll have access to them in the future as long as you continue to have the setup that you currently have. You have a supply and you have this method that only you know currently. I guess Quellen probably could figure it out if she had to.
Because even though she's in business with us and she's awfully, officially part of the gang, like she's on our sheet and everything. But I think somewhere in his schemy little Skurlock bloodline, Oscar probably has her make most of the pieces, but he does the final mixing himself.
Uh-huh.
There's just that whisper from Sitara, just that indication that he should just keep it a little bit. And so
Jesse can't cook as good as Walter.
There's
the measurements are a little different. There's just a little
I love how we all keep changing around what characters from Breaking Bad we are. Like, I used to be Jesse, but I'm starting to worry I might be Badger at this point. I need to get up in the world. Gotta give me some Gustavo Fring action going on over here.
That's right.
All right.
Try to be Mike.
Yeah. No, RC is Mike. You are Mike, for
that's
sure.
That's true.
So, yeah.
You want to be Gus. Come on.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I just want to point out, remember, I just used up half of everything we've ever made, but,
hey.
That's what R&D is for.
All right.
I'm
good.
To make it right.
No, I absolutely think Kanner should, like, lose his shit over it, but as a player, absolutely. It's awesome.
Yeah, totally, yeah. Adam is stoked. Cantor's gonna probably be pissed. Where'd all the money go?
I got nice hats to buy.
That's right. Where's the money, Lebowski?
Sweet. Okay. So Adam, do you have ideas for a second downtime action? Are you vicing out?
Yeah, I think that's the point when I'll probably, like, you know, go drinking with my new friend.
Oh yeah, you want to go out with Brogan? Sure.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Like once I get the tattoo, I'm all like hopped up on adrenaline and whiskey and Viking bro vibes. Yeah, we'll go out and get tore up.
Nice. So how would you like to express luxury in your outing?
Yeah, because my that's what my vice is, right? Is like,
yeah,
getting
you want
fancy.
The good stuff in some way, right?
Totally. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I wanna like go somewhere that's like just like a little outside my league, like where I think that, like, because I got a pretty good, like, even if I can't necessarily afford it, I got a pretty good idea on the sort of pulse of things. I know the, like, the clubs that the ballers get up in, and I want to go to one of those. That's my thought.
Okay. Yeah. There is a place in your district, in fact.
Okay.
It's called the Black Tree, and it's known, it's a Skovlender bar, actually. That has this incredible Skovlender whiskey stock.
Yeah.
Brought over from the old country, like old dusty bottles that are
Sounds like the name of the bartender, Dusty Bottles.
Dusty Bottles.
Dusty Bottles.
Yeah, it's definitely out of your league. It's the kind of place you could go once a year or something, you know. But it's a special occasion, and you want to indulge yourself, and instead of a fancy new coat, decided to
treat yourself.
Yourself.
I'm treating myself.
A nice drink at night.
Sean, do you wanna do us a favor and just toggle your webcam on and off? You're a spinny circle. There you are. Look at you, you handsome devil. You're back.
Hey,
I
was having a little bit of network bandwidth issue, so I was killing apps that might have been
nice, stuck
in a bandwidth, and it seems like
yeah, you're back. Everything's fine now.
Cool.
Yeah. So I wanna impress this dude, and also generally like impress everybody there. Like, I'm working a double angle, right? Where I'm like, I'm gonna take this guy to a cool place, but I'm also going to show up at the cool place with the guy, right?
Yeah.
So that's my jam.
Gotcha. Okay. Okay, so for free, when you indulge your vice, you get to clear one stress plus your vice rating, which I think is currently one.
Okay, yeah.
So you get two stress off the top.
Okay.
Where does that put you?
I think it puts me at, like, one more.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Yeah.
You can clear four more stress if you overindulge and then weird things happen to you, but you probably don't need to.
Yeah, no, I'm okay with being a little stressed.
And you have an opportunity, since you're out of your element here in a pretty nice little area, you can mingle with, I know you're not good at consorting, that's not your thing, really.
It's not really my jam, it's true.
But you have, in a way, sort of bought the opportunity to do that with some richer folks. If you want to try to reach out to potentially wealthier clients, You're in a position to do that tonight, but if you don't,
yeah, no, I think we're still, I think we're still like street level guys, yeah. So I don't really want to push it too hard.
It would be a really desperate thing for you to make here.
No, I mean I'm good in desperate situations. Like I get the extra die when I'm making a desperate roll. So that being said, maybe I like initially I'm like, no, I'm just gonna play it cool, just gonna go out with my buddy. Maybe I drink a little too much, and then I'm like, fuck it, I'm here, I might as well. And I start like probably telling people like maybe the wrong people, but I start putting the word out to be like, yeah, we got this new deal going on with this guy, and like, you know, trying to get, like do that thing that Cantor does where I talk big. To inflate my own self sense of worth.
There's this lady in there. This dark skinned Eruvian with like silver streaks. She's a Leviathan hunter captain.
Yeah, what's up? I know one of those. Yeah, you're way prettier than her.
She likes to drink in this place. She has this really nice. She's wearing a suit. This really nice like fitted jacket and this, like high collar and silk tie and but you can tell like she's all weather beaten and. She has the look of a Leviathan captain. You see them all around all the time.
Yeah,
very, very important. You know, they basically run. They're in charge of the things that the nobles use to rule the world. So they're very important people.
Sweet.
And as across the bar, like you see, like a Leviathan tentacle tattoo, like peeking up out of her collar.
Oh, my love.
And like right. another, like a twisting serpent on her wrist. That you can barely see under her sleeve.
Totally, yeah, and this is the like the totally the thing that Cantor would be into. Like, yeah, I would be like, hey, you got tattoos? I got a new tattoo today. Check it out, and like, you know, like try to.
You're like in the fancy bar, like pulling your shirt up.
And... Yeah, totally. Nice. Not being a classy dude in the cool place. Yeah, Cantor's not good at being cool.
He really is not.
He's just not good at it. He's just too earnest about being. A badass in whatever that means for him.
So let's give her a name. She is Eruvian, so she probably has an Eruvian-ish kind of name. Let's see. Lania is her name.
Cool.
Captain Lania. And she... She's not put off by your demeanor right away, so you have a chance to actually interact with her. She deals with sailors all the time, so she's somewhat intrigued that you're in here, and then she sees right. what you're drinking, and she's just kind of impressed with your taste.
Yeah, that's right.
So instead of just sort of rolling her eyes and brushing you off, she sits in and lets you behave that way in front of her for a little while.
Yeah, into it.
So you can go for it. You get die for a desperate action. This is totally desperate.
Gonna give her.
It sounds like you're consorting with her, but if you want to take a different tack, you can. You can choose a different action if you want.
I mean, I got I don't really have like I have sway, I guess, but I'm not really. It's consort is the,
so
it's
sway
the real thing.
Sway does apply to manipulation and seduction. It's not nearly.
Well, then I'm gonna take that angle.
If you want to take that angle, you can.
Yeah.
That moves it out of the realm of friendly conversation into something else.
That is the realm into which Cantor Haig would like to go.
All right.
Onward to that brave frontier.
If there's some sort of double desperate. That's
supreme desperation.
Reverse double.
I see you checking out my new tattoo. All right. So I get my sway die.
You get your sway die.
Yeah. And then my bonus one from Daredevil.
You're a Daredevil, so you get a... Mm-hmm. When things are desperate, you do better.
Yep. So I got two dice, right?
Yep. You can spend two stress for a bonus die, and you can take a Devil's Bargain if you want more dice.
Yeah, why not? Why not take the... Let's undo the stress that I had before. Let's get rid of those.
Sure. That's what it's there for.
All right. Cool. So I'm rolling three dice.
Yep.
I think that will be sufficient.
All right. I have a Devil's Bargain, but if you don't want it, that's fine.
Well, let's hear it.
Well, I wasn't passive-aggressively trying to get you to ask. I was just... I couldn't shut up there for a moment.
I don't know that I believe you, but go ahead and just... it's fine. Just lure me in.
I was just thinking she's a Leviathan Hunter Captain.
Spit it out, John.
She's a Leviathan Hunter Captain. She probably knows Captain Strangford. She might remember this in a future interaction that might connect some dots that normally wouldn't be.
Oh yeah, totally. I mean, I'll take it because I assume the fallout will not be on me, but on Arcee.
So. It's on Arcee. Yeah.
Yeah, fuck that shit. Sean's not even in the call right now, so let's get him. Let's just pile it on. Let's do it. I'll take my extra die.
Nice. Always the best kind of devil's bargains, right? When they point at the other.
Yeah, exactly. Aim it at somebody else. Do it to Julia. All right. Cool. I'm in.
So, are you up to four now?
Yeah, I'm at four dice.
Four dice, desperate action, seduction move on Captain Lania.
Let's do it.
Good luck.
Here we go. We're rolling. I got a six. Hey! Yay. Yeah.
Man. You are. Tonight is your night.
I know. It's true.
Tattoo, new buddy. Yeah. Seducing a Leviathan Hunter Captain.
That's right. Do we want to take a break and try to get Sean back in and
sure,
then we can pick up there? Does that sound good?
That sounds great.
Okay, cool. Well,
sounds like a plan. I need to use the bathroom anyway.
All right, cool. Well, I'll flip it over and we will come back in just a couple of minutes. We'll see if we can get Sean back in and continue where we were at.
Cool.
Stick around.